Dr. Amte, thanks for coming. I wanted to start with your family. You know, Baba Amte was your father and the very well-known person. Tell us a little bit about him.
Actually, my father, he was a landlord. And he got influenced with Gandhi's movement, 42 independence movement. And he left everything and came back and settled in a small village in Chandrapur district. And he was a lawyer by profession. But while practicing law, he realized that only the rich person would get the justice, not the poor man. So he left his practice. And then one day he saw a leprosy patient on the road with a lot of wounds and maggots in the, and he was on the deathbed almost, lying on the side of the road. And he got scared. During those days, a leprosy patient in the family was a taboo, so they used to drive him out. Any family, all over India. And he realized afterwards that if my wife and my sons get leprosy, would I drive them out? He came back again, took him to his house, dressed him. Unfortunately, he died because he was in the last stage. And then he took a decision to start a leprosarium in 1949. He took a training in Calcutta School of Tropical Medicine with a special permission. And in 49, when I was 1 year old and my elder brother, just 14 months old, he applied to government of Central Province to give him a land. And they gave him a 50 acres of reserve forest near in Chandrapur district. And he, with his wife, means my mother, was a very from a rich family in Nagpur. Both of them intentionally decided to do the work for the leprosy patient with their two small children. And whole world disowned him, including the relatives, including the father. Mm-hmm. I remember our childhood, because we were so small in that time. It was isolation. Myself, my brother Vikas, and mother and father, they were the so-called healthy, living in a leprosarium with hundreds of leprosy patients around. Why the people were afraid of leprosy patients, you know, because they thought it's highly contagious. And then you get deformities and all these things, so society doesn't look good at them. So naturally, they were begging. So once he started the leprosy, in the name of Maharogi Seva Samiti, a lot of patients started coming.
You know, so your father moved from a very wealthy lifestyle in Nagpur to a village, to a tribal area, really, to start this leprosy colony. And you went there when you were a year old, and you grew up in that situation where you really had to live like the people around you. Now, when you grew up, you went to college. You actually, you said that you saw that there was a need for medicine in that. So you decided to become a doctor, and you went back to college. How was the transition for you, having grown up in this area, and then to go to Nagpur to go to college? How was that transition for you?
Actually, we had not known any competition till then. And we were, actually, in the primary education, we learned with these farmers and laborers children. And what actually education and city life is, we did not know. Fortunately, myself and my brother were in the same class. So we both got the admission, and we went to Nagpur. And the atmosphere was so different, so affluent, and all these things. And there were a lot of ragging, you know, during those days, medical college people, students used to do the ragging. And we had a very simple khadi cloth, so it was a target for them to do the ragging. So as and when the holidays came, we used to go to the Anandwan, which was 100 kilometers away, and spend a holiday there rather than spending with these affluent medical students. Yeah. But somehow we got through all the examinations, first MBBS, second MBBS, and final MBBS examination. And then by the time Baba has got some recognition, a lot of people started coming, including the relatives. And suddenly he said, now that you have appeared for final MBBS examination, we'll go for a picnic. We are awaiting result. And picnic where? We had never heard of that place. It's called Bhamragad. It's in the deep, 250 kilometers away from Anandwan. So we all went in a pickup van, and we had to cross six rivers through the riverbed in a four-wheel jeep. It took about two days to reach that place. And we were really happy that he brought us in a nice place where there was no electricity, a lot of stars and moon lighting there. And in the next 2 days, he showed us the life of that particular area. The tribals, one of the most primitive tribe called Madia, Madia Gon, were living in that area. And they had no clothes to wear, just a small loincloth to cover the private parts. And they were so scared of human beings like you, those who were wearing clothes. So wherever we went to meet them in their villages, they used to run away in the forest. And moreover, some of them stopped them. We tried to talk to them. The language was a barrier. They had never learned Marathi or Hindi, which we knew during that time. So we could see the condition of these people. They were malnourished. The children were had pot bellies and all these things. So after 2 days, before returning to that to Anandvan, my father said, during the last 2 days, what you have seen, though I have worked for leprosy patient, I have seen a lot of sorrow and all these things, but this is something different. A man like you and me is living worse life than the animals. So I want to do something for them.
So your father moved you even further interior.
Yeah.
On a picnic, and then you ended up staying there, and that's where you practice actually today with your wife.
Yeah.
You know, one of the things you talk about is how generous or how tolerant the tribals are. So tell us a little bit about the tribals.
So actually, when we got the land and we started the project in 73, we expected a lot of patients would come. But they had never seen modern medicine or doctors, so nobody came, in fact. It was really frustrating. Mm-hmm. Though we had really hardship, but we were prepared. We had gone there voluntarily. There was no electricity, there were no roads, there was no telephone connection. And even in monsoon, you know, it used to remain cut off for 5 months. So that we had known. So we were mentally prepared. Even my wife, though she was from Nagpur, she never complained about it. But we never expected that the patient wouldn't come for the treatment. So we used to go to their villages, try to convince them. They say, we have got our witchcraft in every villages. We'll go to him, sacrifice goat, chicken, sometimes even human sacrifice was also practiced.
Human sacrifice.
So then what to do? Then we said, you bring the patients which were not cured by your witchcraft. And then they brought the first patient who got himself burned because they used to sleep by the side of fire in winter. It's too cold there. So he was 40% burned, he had epilepsy, and moreover, he had maggots in his wounds. So the witchcraft couldn't cure him, he brought him here. We treated him with antibiotics, we gave him anti-epileptic, and within a month he got cured. So that was the first case that a lot of more patients started coming, a patient who was about to die. And second patient, I will tell you, there are a lot of cases of fever. We had no laboratory, how to diagnose it. And a man came from 25 kilometers on a stretcher, bamboo stretcher. The procession came through different villages. So many people came to know that the serious patient was brought to our small cottage hospital. And we were worried what to do now, how to diagnose it. So myself and my wife, Mandakini, we decided on some diagnosis and started the treatment. It was a cerebral malaria that we thought. So we treated with quinine and other life-saving drugs. And he opened his eyes on third day. On the fifth day, he said, now I'm all right. I am going back. So he carried his own stretcher on his shoulder on the same path, and that was the advertisement. Lot more patients started coming. Then we did not have to go again to the people. Yeah. They started coming from different places.
Yeah. And then, you also talked about a very ironic case. Can you tell us about the bear attack?
I mean, they live in a thick forest. So there are a lot of cases of bear bites. There are a lot of cases of snake bites. Wild boar bites. But one case which I still remember is that he was brought from 60 kilometers, which took him 48 hours on the shoulder. Mm. And his eyes were blinded. There was a severe bear bite and the scalp was out. And he was talking to me. He couldn't see anything. The whole body was saddled with blood and all clots. So I treated him, washed his scalp. It was soiled with mud and leaves and all these things. And then I said, we had very few medicines during that time. So now I want to cover your skull with the skin which is loose. So we must stitch it. He said, okay, you go on. I said, I don't have any anesthetics and all this. He said, you can carry on. So I gave the first stitch. I said, this will pain you have to bear. He said, okay, go on. So I gave him 100 stitches without anesthesia. And he didn't shout at all. I mean, he didn't cry. And the relatives were looking at him. They thought that he was given anesthesia. I mean, that much tolerance I had never seen in my life. That has changed inside our life, how we complain about small things. Yeah. And then he got cured. After 2 months, he went back. He was there with us. But he was blind. And then after a year, I inquired about him. He said he died of a malnutrition. Because he was blind, he couldn't collect food for him. Mm-hmm. And those relatives had not enough to eat for themselves. So he used to get red share, and gradually he was eliminated from the society. So that is really a shocking incident for me. What a life, you know. In India, you have to different worlds. Where you have a lot of alternatives you have in the cities, and on the other place, you don't have a single square meal to eat.
Actually, that led you to do something where you learned how to do cataract on your own.
So we both were doctors. My wife was an anesthetist, and I left my surgery. But I was not an ophthalmologist. We saw a lot of cases of cataract in the area, blind persons. Then I decided to call some of my friends from Nagpur. They said, there's no electricity, there's no facilities to go. How can we come there? So then I bought the instruments, I bought the book, and I did my first cataract surgery. The philosophy behind it is that if you do a cataract surgery, if it fails, there's nothing much going to happen to his life because he's already blind. But if I can give him a sight again, it's a rebirth like him. So the first case was really exciting for us. The book was open. My assistant was telling me the steps. I did the first surgery, and I dressed him. And next day, all of my colleagues had gathered around her, the patient. Yeah. And we opened the dressing, and everybody was wondering what will happen now, whether she could see, or it will be blind again. And then I put my fingers on her finger. And she said, it's two, in her own language. And everybody was so overjoyed that the operation was successful. So a lot of patients started coming for us. That grew my confidence, you know. So a lot of patients.
So that's you as a doctor, and you have a very interesting relationship with animals. You have, leopards, you have lions, yeah. You have snakes, and most of the snakes are venomous, and you don't
remove the fangs.
Remove the fangs, etc. So what is it about animals that you love? What makes you so comfortable to put your hand in their mouth?
The Stari's orphanage is a tragic incident. You know, we knew that tribals used to kill and eat animals. But we imagined that animals means a rabbit or a deer or a wild boar and few birds. That's all. But when we had gone, actually seen, they used to eat anything that moves. Anything that moves. I mean, really, it was shocking to us. In India, nobody kills monkeys for food because it has some religious importance. And we saw one day a procession coming with hunted monkeys. And we were really shocked, myself and Mandakini. And the monkeys had a live baby suckling the dead mother. So we stopped. I said, please part this monkey with, please give us baby. And so he said, our children are hungry. How can we give? Then we bargained, we will give you food in exchange of this baby. And that was the first animal in 74, yeah. Almost now 30, 40 years back. And then we fed him with milk powder and bottle feeding and all these things. And we started telling people, please don't kill the young one.
Yeah.
So next animal was the deer, and then the leopard, and the bear, and the crocodile, and whatnot. I mean, now 70 animals, and then I consider them as my family member,
yeah.
All of them. And the only power is power of love. I never use stick, I never use anything to discipline them. And my grandsons, they're so interested, they like all these animals. My grandson sits on the back of a leopard. He catches the snakes around his neck and all these things. So there's this only power of love. Though there is a danger of attack, but I am still alive, you know, after living with them for 40 years.
I really want to acknowledge that it's your whole family. You know, your father did it. Now you and your wife are doing it. Your two sons are back working with you, and their children are now playing with the animals. Yeah, yeah. So you have three generations of people working tirelessly with the tribals, yeah. Etc. So my last question to you is, you've gotten a lot of awards, you know. There's a stamp in you guys' name in Monaco. There is a Magsaysay Award that is from Philippines. And these are all things that have come from outside India. What do you want India to do for your cause?
Actually, we have seen both the lives in India. I mean, we live in another world where almost 40% of the population live below poverty line, BPL. And then what I personally feel that, why I started this work? Because my father, Baba, has exposed me to their conditions. And then that has turned my, that was a turning point in my life. Otherwise, I would not never known this tribe if my father had not taken me to that place. So I feel that the people living in cities, young generation especially, If they can intentionally go and see such projects, see the lives of our own fellow brothers, and then there is a realization that I have experienced. A lot of young generation has taken inspiration and started in their own way the social work in different places. So that is really encouraging. So what I feel, and I appeal to all of you, I mean, if you, and when you get time, you please do come and at least visit our place. This is an open invitation to all.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you very much.